Hi, everybody. Welcome to the live today with Mad Max.
Instantaneous enlightenment.
Hi, guys. Hi. Hopefully you can hear okay. Hi, Mom. Oh, hi, Max.
Oh, it worked.
It worked.
It worked. First time I do this.
First time, hey?
It's pretty easy, though, I guess.
Can you hear me okay? Is the music too loud?
No, I hear you fine.
Okay.
Yeah. Do you hear me good?
Yeah, I hear you perfectly.
Everybody else hears you good? Here's your screen.
Hi, Mom.
Hello, everybody.
Mom's online.
Mom's online. Hey, yeah. Mandy. How are you, Mandy? Nice. It's good to have your mom around.
Yeah.
I haven't seen her for a while.
Yeah, so you can see everybody coming up, right, Max?
Yeah, I see it, yeah.
Okay.
That's cool. My first time. I'm like a virgin. You're popping my cherry.
First time to live Instagram?
Yeah, first time, yeah. Yeah.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah. I've never even, nothing. Feeding the AI with some more information now.
Yeah.
How you doing, Domino? You're good?
Yeah,
hi,
I'm
Mandy. Well, good. Well, it's good to be here with everybody.
Yeah, welcome. And, thanks for taking some time out to do this.
Thank you for doing the same.
Yeah. Hi, everybody. Let us know if you can't hear or if the music's too loud or anything, please. So far, so good. Whereabouts are you right now, Max?
I'm at home. I'm in Spain. I'm in Barcelona, near Barcelona, in a little town. And it's really nice here. It's still pretty cool, weather. It's not too cold. Still, somewhat, but we're in the best part of Europe for that. So it's sunny. I have the beach next to me. And not that I go there, but I went to that.
Well, lucky you. We have just snow here right now. So.
Yeah, I heard you've got some pretty bad floods too over there where you're at.
Yeah, floods, and apparently we have a snowstorm coming. Who knows if that's going to happen?
Oh, that's hard. Good.
Well. But I wanted to start by going a little bit back in time.
Yeah, let's go back in time.
Back in time. So I wanted to know how everything started for you, Max, and I know that you've had, a few different projects, right? And so before you were Mad Max.
Uh-huh.
Before
I was Mad Max. I was just Max.
Just Max. Yeah, and then how did you start with the electronic music? How did that come about?
It's a long story, and I can tell you the story if you like.
Yeah.
It all started more or less around 1996, and a friend of mine had brought me a tape, and he came from France. I was living in Santa Cruz, and he gave me a tape from all kinds of weird electronic music, and I didn't like it. And then I started playing the tape, and I started liking it a bit more and a bit more and a bit more. And it was the same tape every day. I didn't know anything. So that was the kind of initial thing. And I used to listen to a lot of electronic music when I was real young. Like my dad used to make electronic music as well when I was a kid. I was hanging out in the studio every day with my dad, and he was making the weirdest shit ever and stuff, really out there stuff. So it was always in my life, let's say. Yeah.
Okay.
Electronic music. And so, when that friend came and brought me that tape. After that, I had another friend who listened to electronic music, and she listened to trance. And she was a friend from school. And she said, oh, I'll take you to your first party if you'd like. And New Year's Eve of 1996 to 1997 in San Francisco.
In San Francisco,
San Francisco, yeah. And it was a private party. It was a warehouse party. It was underground, very underground. And I'd never, you know, even thought of going to one. I didn't really know where to go anyway. So I said to my dad, I said, you know, I'm going to go to this thing tonight. But he would always say yes to everything. Yeah. But it was raining that night and it was really bad. It was like really hardcore rain. And he said, tonight is too dangerous. You shouldn't go. It's New Year's. And I wouldn't do it. You know, please don't go. So I said, shit. So I got out, took the truck. I took my dad's truck and I went anyway. So he knew I went, obviously.
Yeah.
And that was the best thing I ever did because I met everybody that are still friends today with me, people that really dear to my heart and people I've done a lot of stuff with and had a lot of experiences with. And
okay.
Really, really old friends now since that night, since I actually went there. And after that, 4 months later, I got together with some friends who had a shop in Santa Cruz, which was a psychedelic trance shop with actual like space drive clothing and vinyls and records and CDs and tapes and anything they could, you know, sell related to psytrance because that was the underground thing to do.
Okay.
And then they didn't want the shop anymore and they asked me if I wanted to take over. And that was 4 months into my psytrance experience already, and I became a shop owner of a psychedelic trance shop in California.
Oh, and wow.
It was called the Ion Exchange. And we
Ion
used to
Exchange.
Sell.
Okay.
Yeah, it was called the Ion Exchange because when you exchange ions, it means that you're, hanging out with people. And by that, you're exchanging ions. Yeah. So we sold vinyl, like I said, anything we could. Tapes, Goa Gil tapes, all the series.
Goa Gil tapes.
Yeah, we had this black light room where we sold the clothes, and we gave people the 3D glasses to. So we said to them, you know, this is how you're going to see your clothes once you're fucked up at the party. This is the way it's going to look. Yeah. And so, wow, killer. Nobody had that, you know, back then. It was '97.
Oh wow.
And we lived in the shop. And we weren't supposed to do that, obviously, but back then we were kids, and my two partners were from India.
Okay.
And so we lived in the shop, and we took showers at the gym across the street, and the guy at the towels, this is a story I tell when I have to tell this story, and the guy at the towels would always ask us what we did there, because I had long hair, one half dreadlocks, one half long hair, and Space Tribe clothes up to here, and it's like, what the fuck do you guys do here? You don't like work out, yeah? Why don't you work out? So well, we have a store there, so we need showers, so we take a shower, spa, jacuzzi, everything else, but not work out. Yeah.
Not work out.
I do now, but yeah, not back then, and so. And so he said, well, what do you do? So we have a shop. I said, well, oh, okay. Well, we have a studio. And then I said, okay. And they say, okay, you guys like to smoke? I said, yeah, sure. I said, okay, cool. So that was Nick Mechanica was the guy at the towels. And
oh,
so
nice.
We went to their studio and Sammy CPU was there and he was making some tracks, nothing to do with trance music because they didn't know. And I got in the studio and I said, what's up? That's how it started. And then we instantly gelled and brought them to their trans party, first trans party experience and all that. Then we started making music together. And that started to be biodegradable. That was my first project with
biodegradable.
These guys.
Okay.
Yeah. And so that's when we moved to San Francisco. We started biodegradable and it was me and Sammy and Nick. Sammy CPU and Nick Mechanica. And that was the first ever kind of project any one of us had started doing with trance music, yeah? Knowing not much about how to do it, except those guys knew a lot more than me because I was DJing. I became a DJ with all the records I could get from the record store.
Okay. I went to that. So, okay.
So that was the beginning, yeah?
The beginning.
In California.
So in the beginning, So if I'm getting correct, in the beginning you were actually DJing.
That's right. Yeah,
okay.
I was DJing. Yeah.
And what was your like DJ name then?
I don't even remember. I think so many different like ideas. Like, I think it was just Max. Yeah, okay. So, like, we tried Climax with 3X, and then we tried out, like, that didn't work.
Okay. All right. So interesting. So yeah. You actually were DJing first then?
Yes, that's
okay,
right.
Okay, cool.
Yeah. And so, because I had all the music.
Yeah.
I would get out music every week, distributed, and I would just go to San Francisco with my friends and pick it up in vinyl and CDs and stuff. And, you know, so we had turntables back then. It was mostly turntables.
Okay, so you started DJing with turntables then?
That's right, yeah.
Okay. And you were just DJing in the States?
Yeah, in California, yeah. San Francisco, and then I started to get more gigs, you know, slowly and in that time. There wasn't that much going on, but yeah. And I had my first gig was in Canada, actually, outside.
In Canada?
Yeah, as a DJ.
Okay, which part of Canada?
It was in Ontario. It was I think it was around Ontario.
Okay.
Yeah.
And that was, what year was that then? 90-something, right?
98. 98? 99, maybe, yeah. Yeah, first time I went to play somewhere, I was booked. I played as biodegradable because I was DJing it anyway.
Okay.
So, that was the first gig.
98. So how old were you about?
98. I was 20. Okay. 21. Yeah, 21, I think. I can't even remember. I think 21.
Wow.
Yeah.
Cool. So you were a DJ. You were a DJ, y'all.
That's right. I didn't DJ DATs, though. I didn't DJ DATs. I couldn't afford the DAT player at the time. Yeah, I used to work at the gas station at Chevron and shit, and that great graveyard shift, and all the jobs you could think of that you wouldn't do, I did them. Trash, pick up trash. We used to pick up trash with Nick, too, in San Francisco. But, like, as a job, heavy trash, like industrial trash. All kinds of restaurant jobs, and you know, to pay for the music, basically, because you start to need to buy equipment, especially back then. You had to buy equipment.
Yeah,
you couldn't do anything without, you know, $10,000.
Yeah,
and you had to learn that whole thing and how it worked, and you know, it was no one knew how to make psytrance or go at it.
Yeah. Well, it has so many. I mean, that's another thing I get. Like, I mean, what do you call it nowadays? I don't really know. You know, that's another discussion I always have. It's like goa trance, psy trance. It's like, I don't know.
There's so many now genres. It started as goa trance. It started as, you had those artists, and that's all you had, and that was it. Yeah, and they play whatever they like to play, and that's they all had this sound that no one else had because it was kind of hard to do. Yeah.
Yeah.
But we had a warehouse in San Francisco. And so we used to make parties in one warehouse, first of all. It was called CCC. And that was where kind of all the parties started in San Francisco, the really kind of underground Goa people who went to Goa and would come back to San Francisco and spend like time there and then go back to Goa in the season.
Yeah.
The American San Francisco side of the Goa scene. Yeah. And that's where they made the party. So that's where I used to go party. And then that finished when the dot-com industry came into San Francisco. The dot-com industry, like, ravaged all these little things because they took over all the buildings so they could make offices because they thought the dot-com thing would, like, you know.
Okay.
And then dot-com kind of went down and then made Silicon Valley. So now it's all Silicon Valley and San Francisco as well. But yeah. So we had another warehouse with Nick and Sam and my ex, Davina, with whom I did Serious Business.
Yeah.
So that's how we ended in San Francisco. And yeah.
Okay, so you were DJing, and then you were hanging out with Nick and all those, and then when did you actually start producing music then?
With them, I learned with them and Sammy a lot. I used to write down everything in the notebook and all that, and just to have to like quit smoking so we could remember what we had to do because it was like really important. So I couldn't remember it otherwise. And I had like a lot of notes and a lot of practice and hours of practice after work. We had like 2 or 3 jobs in the day, and we had to come make music at night. And it was very kind of like, it was hard on the body, but we were young, so it was cool.
Yeah.
And then I moved to Mexico.
Okay.
And
what year was that you moved to Mexico?
That was in 2003. I moved everything to Mexico.
Hi, Mark.
And started. Hey, Mark. There he is. And in Mexico, I moved with Davina. My ex was with who I did Serious Business, and we started Serious Business really there, actually. Yeah, and we didn't know much, but we had to figure
it out. So that was in Mexico.
In Mexico City,
Okay. Yeah, because that's how I know you, right? That's how I met you when you were with your ex as that
that project, yeah.
Yeah, that project, yeah. Because I think the first time I met you guys, I think was in Japan, if I remember correctly.
I think so.
Yeah.
I think so. And the first time I actually met you, I didn't meet you, but it was in 2001 in Home Beach.
Oh yeah, that's true.
But I saw you play.
Yeah.
No. But you were there. I saw you, and I saw you play, and I really thought it was really the best, like, killer set.
Thank you. Then. Oh, that was I think I played after GMS, right? I think so.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh. That was long time ago. That was a cool party, actually.
3 days. Yeah.
3 day party. Yeah.
3 days. Yeah.
Yeah, and then I think when I met you guys was in Japan, and I was trying to think what year that was. But...
2005, probably, for Arcadia.
Yeah, it was for Arcadia, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that
most
was
likely.
Cool.
Yeah. Those were the nice years in Japan.
Okay, sorry. So let's go back. So, yeah, so you started making that project in Mexico, right?
Basically, yes. We left San Francisco because it was too hard to focus on music. Yeah, okay. A lot of friends, people would always come over and want to, like, you know, hang out, and in the end you don't have time. So if you want to learn something, especially music, especially production, especially this kind of music, you have to spend, you know, what I think is you have to do this 10,000 hours. Yeah, 10,000 hours is a good amount of hours where you can kind of master your trade. Yeah, if you do that, then it's about 8 hours a day for 5 years every day.
Yeah.
So if you do that and you do 16 hours, then you kind of, like, you know, and then you find ways to, you know, get some more information of how to produce this kind of music. And so once we moved to Mexico, there was a scene in Mexico, because there was not much of a big scene in America at the time. It's still quite small in America somehow. Yeah, it never really caught on. But in Mexico, it's almost pop music. Yeah.
Yeah.
In Mexico, it's so popular that everybody knows psytrance. You know, it's played in taco stands. It's played everywhere. I mean, I've heard my music in taco stands. You know what I mean? Like, that's it's normal.
A bit so, like Israel, yeah.
Pretty much, yeah. Uh-huh. They really love it there. And I mean, without Mexico, I don't know where I would be. Honestly, without Mexican people and the love that Mexican people brought us and gave us everything, that, you know, always so giving and welcoming. So it was a really good choice. And we only had 2 tracks, I think, when we went there. We had no idea really what we were doing, actually. And then we noticed that, you know, there's big parties there, and there was artists coming. And so we would, you know, get in touch with the artists who were coming from abroad, like, who, you know, big artists like Altum and, you know, Absalom and Talamasca. And we would invite them over, you know, and they would come over and we'd talk about music, and they would show us stuff, or they would make a track with us. And that was, like, amazing. So we would learn, like, so fast, because we could see, like, how, you know, it's done.
Yeah.
So that really, really helped, and I really thank all the people who, you know, on my journey have participated to, you know, give me all these great clues as to how to make this music. Like Chelly was there a lot, and he showed us how to make a live set. Like, I had no clue. We had to play our first live set one day, so we didn't know how to do it.
Wow.
And so Chelly, he was there, and he was willing to help. So, and that was in 2003. Figure out how to do it. The first live set was like something out of this world.
Wow.
It was a party in Acapulco, and I think the people who were all there all remember this party for the rest of their lives, because it was so chaotic, and it was our first time playing live, me and her, and yeah, it was a big, you know, some big lineup kind of, you know.
Yeah.
And we stayed in the hotel, which is on the party, like right in front of the party. Yeah, first of all, that was the hotel scene. And at the end of the party, there'd been floods in the hotel, and like,
oh my god.
And then people were jumping over the fence trying to come into the party for free, but like loads, yeah. And they dug a tunnel under the fence, under the wall, to come wow. in. And the guy was charging 50 pesos for, at the end of the tunnel, for them to come in anyways. Somebody was making some. And so you had guys with like broken arms coming on the dance floor and just like, yeah, we made it. So that was that kind of party. And
that kind of party.
Yeah, and, we always.
And can I ask you, like for your doing your first live, like were you like nervous or anxious or anything from that
first live set? Yeah, of course. Yeah, you don't know what's gonna not go right, you know.
Yeah.
There's so many options of what could go wrong.
Yeah.
And, but it went right, you know. And it was back then, you didn't really have a backup, you didn't have much, you know. And
yeah,
you know, maybe a CD if you like thought about it. But yeah, we played live, and it was right. It was live. It was cool. Yeah, people. That's how it started, actually. And from
that's
that,
how it started. And then, how long did that? I mean, how long did that project last?
Till 2009, at least.
2009.
Yeah. Okay. I mean, even more. I mean, it lasted for a while. But we weren't together, I think, in 2008. I think that was it. So
okay,
we still play together after that.
Yeah.
It's
and
hard.
Then you, so what you, your first party was, as that project was in Mexico. And where was your, what was your first outside gig? Was that the Japan one?
With, no, it was probably somewhere in Europe.
Somewhere in Europe?
Yeah, because then we moved to Europe, and that's when we started playing in Europe.
Okay.
Yeah. Because Mexico was, you know, it we played there all so much, and we couldn't play more, and we had to move to Europe to go to the next level, to play in festivals, to play in you know, European parties, and
yeah.
come back to Mexico later. But you know, we just kind of played ourselves out, actually, almost. You know, everybody
yeah.
had heard us, but they loved us, and that was incredible to have that. But it was like a push up, you know, from the Mexicans.
Yeah. Really well, nice. I don't think there wasn't many like couple artists. Like there was Man Made Man, obviously.
Yeah.
But apart from that, there wasn't, you know.
There was Analog Pussy. Remember them?
Yeah. Yeah. So
there wasn't much.
So it was kind of. I think it was pretty interesting, you know, for people to.
It was, and I don't know. Somehow, like the way I saw it was like. The people were comfortable watching that because they know the guy knows that, you know, the DJ's not going to get his girlfriend and the girl, you know, and vice versa and all that.
Yeah.
And so they feel like, oh, it's a homie vibe and people are like together. And so it's kind of safe, you know? So in a way, I think they really liked that.
Yeah.
It was different. Yeah. And
yeah.
music was good too. So.
Yeah, definitely.
It wasn't bad. So.
Yeah. I mean, I remember the first time I saw you guys in Japan, I was like, wow, this is so cool. I loved it.
Nice. Good. Yeah. Those Japan parties were great.
Yeah.
Sorry.
And then, so then what was after that, Max? What project was after that?
Well, we stopped in 2008, I think. And then I went traveling for 5 years.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Made a lot of contacts, stayed with all the people that I was playing and party and at, you know, like I stayed for a week or two, and I made a lot of music on the road. I made a lot of my really best tracks on my mom's couch if I had to stay there, or if I had to stay.
Somebody, okay, who's this? Ozzy is asking, what was the name of that project?
The project before was called Serious Business.
Serious Business.
Yeah.
Okay.
And the project before that was called Biodegradable.
Biodegradable.
That was with CPU and Mechanica when we started out. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, and then we broke up. Oh, about 2008, I think.
Yep.
And that's when I started Mad Max. Yeah.
Okay, so around 2008 is when Mad Max appeared.
Yeah, 7 actually. So I'd already done some stuff, and she started
okay.
something else. Yeah, yeah, as well.
And whereabouts yeah. were you when that started, Max?
Hmm.
Which part of the world?
I was everywhere in the world. I was all around the world.
All around the world.
Yeah, yeah. I decided to give my house up, and where I was in Spain, and just go traveling. Go to India a lot and spend a lot of time there, and spend a lot of time in Japan. I was making gigs in Japan. I was organizing some parties there as well at one point. Yeah. I wanted to make this whole party organization thing worldwide, because I was all over the place. And then we started a label. That was around 2011. Yeah.
Okay.
After that,
United Beats.
Yeah, that was we said it was me, Bart, XSI guys, Bart, Jean-Marc, and another friend, Ludo, a Block Device, and French. And we all said, well, let's do a label. We have to do a label, because why not? We have a lot of music, and you know, yeah, we can make art. So yeah, that was 10 years ago. And,
10 years ago.
Yeah, 10 years ago.
And well, that's pretty cool that your label is still going, hey?
Yeah, well, it takes a lot of work and a lot of dedication, and there's a lot of obstacles. And each time you have an obstacle, you want to quit. But if you do, then, wow, that's over. But, you know, things come with a lot of, if you really want them, yeah?
Yeah. You've got to work hard for it, for sure.
That's right. Otherwise, everybody would have an amazing thing, great label, but you know, it'd be easy.
It's
not easy, for sure. Yeah. But it's very rewarding.
Yeah.
You know, once you know you've done the work and gone through all the shit and
shit,
you know,
wanted
to quit and didn't quit. And so, yeah. And then you get to today and things, you know, things happen.
Yeah.
And people respect that as well, I think.
Definitely.
Yeah.
So then Mad Max happened, and so then you were pretty much known pretty much all over the world by then, really.
Yeah, I was still known as Serious Isness as well. And to detach from that took a while to actually just play, you know, Mad Max. I would ask, you know, can you play this too? And because there's still the remains of that era, and the people who know that project. And then it comes to a time where those people don't really know that project, because they're new people come in the scene, and they make parties, and they don't care about that old thing, because they want your new thing that they know.
So
that's when it really started to pick up for Mad Max. Yeah?
For
that project. But it takes time. Like, it takes like a good 5 years to get a project going, you know?
Yeah.
Especially that, even now it's hard, because there's so much competition.
There's so much competition, exactly.
Yeah. You just need a laptop now and some headphones, and you can do it as well, you know?
Yeah.
Back then, not so much.
Yeah.
So, a lot of
I think even for DJs nowadays, there's a lot of competition, so.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Extremely.
Yeah.
That's so available. So, and there's so much of it. So many styles. You can belong to one style and easily now. Before, it was, you know, like we said, it was just Goa. It was a few people only.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that was how I started Mad Max,
And when was the first time you went to Goa as Mad Max then? Like, I know you'd been to Goa before.
Yeah.
But like as Mad Max or, gigging.
Well, the first year I went to Goa was when I saw you at Home Beach in 2001. And I did the India, like, I did 4 months. I was changing my flight maybe like five times and stuff. It was so good. I just like, I couldn't leave. And when I left, I really felt sad. And it was so like home. I even have Indian family. Like, my grandma, she married some Indian person. So I have Indian uncles.
You have Indian? Okay.
Yeah, I actually do. Yeah.
Because you're kind of also pretty mixed. You're from like all over the place, aren't you? Like your background. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I was born in the States, but my mom is like French, but she's Slovak, and my dad is, you know, from Scandinavia style, yeah, American. So it's pretty mixed, Swedish and
And you speak quite a few languages as well, right?
I speak French, English, and Spanish. And Portuguese a bit, because all the Brazil trips. I pick up the languages a little bit quicker because of all the stuff that I. have to like, you know, think in different languages sometimes, otherwise it's survival, you know. Japanese as well, because I spent a lot of time there. Little bit of Japanese, but not much. Not like, you probably speak a lot more Japanese than me, because you spent a lot of time.
I forgot a lot, you know, and for me it was kind of funny. I I kind of like got disheartened to speak Japanese because I learned, like, the way I spoke Japanese was like a guy, because all of my friends were guys there, so it was a bit weird because, you know, there's a way, like, the girls speak to the guys. So I was, yeah, I don't know. I was like, I was speaking like a guy.
Yeah. Well, you speak Konkani anyway, so you can, like, have your way there and go.
Oh, yeah. In India, yeah, I'm like, you know, that's my first, well, yeah, I would say, like, my language, yeah.
Yeah. That's really cool.
And then when I started speaking English, like, when I came back to the UK and Europe, like, it was weird for me because when I spoke English, it was pidgin English, right?
Yeah.
So people were like, okay, where the fuck is she from? And then when I go to India, it's the vice versa. They think I'm taking the piss, right?
Yeah.
So it's like,
You screwed both ways, and Domino. You screwed both ways. That's why you had to go to Canada.
Yeah, it's funny. Yeah,
well, I always like to speak to my little crappy Hindi and to anyone I see who would enjoy it. So yeah, I'm sure you have to enjoy it too.
So where were we? So we were Mad Max, and then you went to India the first time 2001.
Yeah, so that was the time where I actually played there. I met some guys, and I forget where it was, some cafe, yeah, and they were collecting money for a party, yeah.
Okay.
So I asked the guy, I said, is there any way to play? And he said, yeah. He said, but you got to pay $100. And so I said, I don't have much money left for my India trip, you know, but I said, so it would be a really good experience to, you know, I'm here. And he said, look, he says, it's not for you, you know, it's not for us. It's so we can, you know, like, we need the money so the party can happen, basically pay for the sound system and all the shit. I said, okay, I'll play.
Were they Indian guys?
No. And so I end up playing, and they treated me really well. And I played with, I think, Logic Bomb. It was on Spaghetti Beach, I think.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it was quite. And I played as Biodegradable, actually. That was my first, like, in India, actually. But I paid to play. And I was really happy I did, actually. So I paid my dues, you know, when I went to go that first time.
Max, shame. You're one of those DJs who paid to play, seriously?
That's how much I wanted to play in Goa. In 2001, yeah? But there was no other way.
Yeah. No, that's pretty funny.
It was $100. I had it. We got robbed in Goa and all that shit. But...
So you paid $100 to play in Goa.
I did, yeah. Yeah. Fuck, who would have thought, yeah?
Who would have thought, man?
Yeah.
Wow.
But that's life, and that's just an experience. It's like going on a boat ride. You know, you have to pay $100. You can pay $100, and you just do it.
I'm wondering if I was at that party though. What?
XP played, and this guy like from Logic Bomb played, and I forget who else played. It was a nice party, actually.
Yeah, I probably was there, especially Spaghetti Beach. Like, I always went to those parties.
Yeah, I was on the hill. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Right there.
Wow.
So yeah, that's the truth. Yeah, you got to come on Instagram to like find out the fucking truth.
Hilarious.
Yeah.
Well, not really. No, you know what I mean, though. Like seriously.
No, but that's
I remember when we used to bitch at those freaking DJs that used to come, like, you know, the Nine Bar.
Yeah.
Yeah, like DJs used to come, like there used to be a whole lineup for the Nine Bar, and then like DJs DJs that weren't really known. Came then used to pay the guy back. She used to put their name on the list and scrub some of the other DJs out.
I'm not surprised. That is so typical. Yeah,
oh my god.
Yeah. I didn't go there, but it was all like cool, you know. It was all legit.
Oh, funny. Yeah. So basically, your first time you played was 21 in Goa, then.
Yeah.
And then what happened after that, Max? Where did you go after that?
Um, Where did I go? I went back to San Francisco. That was a long time ago, yeah? Yeah. Then we got together with Davina and did the whole project, yeah? So that was my first India out of the, you know, 4 months.
Okay.
I went to places that, wow. I mean, that was with my Indian friend and took me to the families. It was amazing. It was amazing. Yeah. Went to the mountains, you know, yeah. Kashish and all that up there, and Himachal Pradesh. It was incredible.
Yeah,
I mean, played in Himachal Pradesh. I played in that. Yeah, that year I played in Himachal Pradesh too.
And, oh, really?
We took the sound system and we brought it up to this amazing thing and played. I played 11 hours.
Wow.
That was the only DJ because they had two Japanese DJs, or one guy, and this guy started playing, and then he played five tracks, and then he completely disappeared.
So, wow.
So he left. Like, I think he was way too, like, yeah. Huh? And he was not found until morning, so somebody had to play. So I had my CD book, 220 CDs, so that worked.
Crazy.
It was a good experience.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, it's nice. It's nice when you get those. I've only played one long set ever. Well, no, maybe two, but I think my longest set I ever played also was in Portugal, and it was like 8 hours.
Nice. I love it.
Yeah, it's pretty cool.
Yeah. You really get to, like, be a DJ like that, huh?
Yeah,
and tell your story.
Yeah,
and it never breaks because it's just you and it's one channel. Because I mean, DJing is channeling as well. You know,
yes.
If you can forget about yourself,
yeah,
for a minute, you know, then you can forget about yourself for 8 hours. It's amazing.
Yeah,
and then you really like do good. You know,
do good. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Wow, that's crazy.
Yeah, so that was the 2001. And then I think I came back with Serious Business in 2005 or something, India. It was a while back. I think it was a club called, it was called Rock Bottom, I think.
Remember that club? Okay.
In Mumbai?
Okay.
Yeah, I think it was called, yeah.
Wow.
And then, yeah, every year after that, for sure.
Yeah. And then, so Mad Max, and then Mad Max has, you know, you've collaborated with a lot of different artists, like in between that. And then I wanted to talk to you about, you know, Mad Tribe, like when that all started.
It all started actually back then in 2000. It was in 1997, I think. And Ollie used to come to San Francisco and Santa Cruz and he used to play these parties for actually 8 hour sets. Yeah. So I used to go to this, it blew my mind, my first party with him. And so I would go back and then he would play in these amazing places in Santa Cruz in the mountain. And that's where I really got my mind blown for real.
Is that when you first met Ollie then?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. And I didn't really meet him, yeah, but I definitely met him, yeah.
Okay.
And, yeah. So that's where I actually had the vision to do what I do, is to be like, I want to be like that. I want to do, that's what I want to do in my life. Because I mean, whatever it's doing to me right now is incredible. And I want to be able to facilitate that for people in my life. And so he was the detonator of...
So he was like a big inspiration for you, Max.
Hmm. Of course.
Yeah.
I mean, huge inspiration. You know, I mean, whatever he conveyed energy-wise, especially back then when I was completely, you know, new to this, was mind-blowing. Mind-blowing. And it really fixed me as well, like in my head and my heart and... gave me a purpose, and it was so vast, this whole thing that I could get into, that I was really excited because it was to the good that you could do to people.
Yeah.
With this job, if you can call it a job, yeah, but it is a job in the end. And so I'd never really spoken to him, but one day I spoke to him at a party where I played before him, and it was the first time I was playing in the same thing. He was playing after me. And he came up to me and he patted me on the back and he said, "Nice set." I said, "Wow." He likes my set. So in the morning, I went to see him and he was sitting down just smoking. And I went to see him finally. And I said, "You know," I looked at him, I was in another state of mind as well. I said, "You know, I have dreams about you sometimes." Because he would come into my dream and he would tell me what track to play and stuff. I was a bit out there. And so he heard me, he saw me, and he got up and he like tapped me on the shoulder and said, "All right, mate, see you later."
All right, mate.
And so that was how I met Ollie.
Wow, that's so and, cool.
I never thought that anything would happen with Ollie and him, but
yeah,
it really
you
did.
You guys were like brothers. Yeah.
Yeah. Then I met him in Japan, and then he invited me to make music with him in Australia when he was living there. So that was the first kind of real invitation to come, and then we saw that how easy it was to work together, and that was something to pursue, you know, for sure. So we pursued that definitely after that. So we'd made some tracks as Serious Isness, and they were great. And he still played them in his sets. They were from 2005, you know, 4 or 5. He really liked them. So yeah, that's how we really started and made a lot of music together since then.
Yeah.
And he became, you know, best friends and, you know, travel partners and, you know, just, you know, partners in crime, you know, everywhere.
Partners in crime, yeah.
Yeah.
What was your first album as Mad Tribe?
As Mad Tribe, it was Spaced Out.
Spaced Out.
It was in 2015. And okay. That's when we came up with the concept and the design. And Ollie's brother, Mikey, he does all the designs.
All the designs,
connected to the clothing. And then, you know, we started making clothes with the Mad Tribe line through Space Tribe. So Mikey, Ollie's brother, would design everything and put it on the t-shirts. And then we made all this, you know, we have cushion covers. We have all kinds of stuff.
Hi, Striker.
Hey, Striker. So yeah, that's how it started with Mad Tribe, and that's our first album with Mad Tribe was Spaced Out, and it was a good success. It was very good success, actually.
Yeah.
And it's just like all the love and the, you know, connection and similar taste and, you know, complicity in the studio and all that makes it so it's, you know, special.
Yeah. And you guys toured pretty much all over the world together.
Basically, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Once it started, it really started real quick, and we started playing a lot. So it did a lot of good to both of our projects as well, and, you know, it just only did good, you know, mm-hmm. basically. We focused all our energy on that rather than our solo projects.
Solo projects, yeah.
Because you can't do everything, you know, perfect, so you have to choose a bit, so you give a bit more percentage to that. But it really, it propulsed it to the top, the whole thing, because we'd play three live sets every time we travel together every time. It was just more fun too, because, you know, traveling alone can be pretty boring.
Boring.
You know, you're more strong when you're two. You know, there's a problem, somebody can help. If one is sick, one can take care of the other. You know.
Yeah.
So yeah, I mean, there's always a situation where you need your friend there for sure.
Yeah. Wow.
And he was a very good friend, and very, very sad that he's no longer with us, for sure.
Yeah.
So, I'll smoke a toke to Ollie.
Yeah. Yeah, that was, you know, very devastating. Very much so.
Yeah, it was devastating to everybody. He was loved by so many people.
He knows
so many people. So he did a lot of good, and he was very loving to everyone, all of his friends, and very honest and, you know, very straightforward and no bullshit, and you know, always know the truth with him, and, you know, that's what made him so amazing as well.
Yeah.
And so creative and drive to do stuff. I mean, much more drive sometimes than me, you know. I mean, I find myself being much more lazy than Ollie, and he was 20 years older than me. Yeah. So he's definitely being missed right now, you know, for sure.
Yeah, and how does it feel for you, like, I mean, you know, going and doing the lives without him? It must feel a little bit strange sometimes.
The first live I did was quite shortly after his passing, and I mean, I cried for half an hour at the end of the set because it was so fresh and, you know, it really devastated me for sure. Like, I mean, still, of course, but
yeah.
But the initial shock was like, what the fuck, you know? What is this? How is this possible? It's not possible, you know? It can't be possible, you know? But then you know, reality does sink in at one point, unfortunately, or fortunately. It has to anyway. It also is healing, yeah?
Yeah.
To deal with it, to do that for yourself. And I did some healing stuff as well after that to, get it out. Yeah.
Get it out of this. Yeah. And it's also, you know, what's nice for you, Max, is you've got like so many, like, you know, like those memories will never go. And,
no.
You know, and also you have lots of like videos of you guys together. So that's kind of nice, right? Like,
yeah. No, we have a lot of memories together and it's never going to. It's never going to change because that's happened. So
and you still go out and you still play as Mad Tribe, right? Or you just
we still have tracks to release, actually.
So, oh wow,
that's going to happen. And I'm going to continue as much as I can, because his legacy has to live on, and I think this is a very good way for it to live on. It's I'm not going to play Space Tribe, or no one is. So somebody has to, I know with my closeness to him, how he operates and how, what he would like. And I know he would agree on that sound. So I know I can get there. Yeah. And it'll be good to have him, ethereally there with me when I do some music. Yeah.
So before he passed, you had some like tracks that you were making together that haven't been finished.
Yeah, that's correct. Yeah.
Okay.
So that'll be released next year. Yeah.
Oh, wow,
I couldn't get to it now because it was too fresh, and I took a break from everything, and I actually even took a 1 week vacation, which is very rare.
Yeah.
But it was actually very good.
Yeah.
So now I'm getting back into a straight headspace a bit more. Yeah. To be able to work.
Yeah. To work, yeah.
But it definitely, like, it screws you up real bad. You know?
Well, yeah, I mean, you know.
Yeah, and the family, I mean, everybody was devastated, of course.
Yeah.
But there's a lot of music to enjoy still, and, we did a lot of stuff. So there's, it will live on.
Can I ask? Around how many tracks do you think that you and Ollie produced together? Or is that a tricky question?
Maybe like around 50 or 60, no, 50 or 60 maybe.
Wow.
Yeah, at least that. Yeah.
Okay.
If I really go back, maybe I'm large, but I don't know.
Yeah.
I calculated I did about 400 tracks in general.
Wow.
Maybe more. Yeah, it's hard to see because there's tracks that aren't online because they're so old, so you can't find them anymore, but
yeah
it's about that or more.
Okay. And you've also collaborated with quite a few different other artists too, right? So
yes,
I wanted to talk about that also a bit, like what artists, and they're all on your label?
No, I've collaborated with pretty much the whole scene, at least like all the
old school guys. S-Range.
Hey, S-Range. Hey, Michael. Hey, everybody again. Sorry we're like dissing you guys. But
yeah, we're it's not like we're ignoring you, but it's kind of hard to concentrate and talk at the same
time.
We're
old school. We have to do this.
Exactly.
We can't multitask like all the young kids.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. What were we saying?
I was gonna ask like who you've all collaborated with and which ones are on your label and which ones you've collaborated that are not on your label.
Oof, that's a long list. I don't know if I can go through everybody.
Well, but you've made tracks with S-Range, you've made tracks with Striker.
S-Range, Striker, GMS, and Mechanica. Asterix, we did a lot of stuff with remixes as well. What else? Ace Ventura with Alpha Portal.
Avalon,
Tristan. I don't know, mostly all of the people that you can think of, I think, the track with them. At least I remixed a lot of GMS stuff, like the old stuff. Old stuff I really like to remix. The new stuff is like, it's already new, so I don't know, you know, it's got to age. It's like age the wine, and then you can kind of open the bottle kind of thing again. But yeah, I like to do old remixes like Land of Freedom. And if the artists let me do it, because they, you know, they're big tracks, and you know, sometimes like people don't want to. I know I don't want to have my tracks remixed by just anybody or. Doesn't really matter, but it has to be special anyway.
Is there, can I ask you another tricky question? Like who do you feel more, well, actually it's not a tricky question because I know probably it would be Ollie, but outside of Ollie, who's the most, like the most, you know, fun or easiest to make tracks with?
Oh, my friends, my really good friends, usually like Hero Striker, Mechanica, I don't know. Who do I make tracks with? Easy. lately, I was in Mexico with Tron. He's really fun. Actually, I have a bad memory of.
Yeah. And then how long does it normally take you to produce a track?
To make the whole thing story-wise, and mixed kind of nice, about 3-4 days.
3-4 days.
If I'm there for 3-4 days in a row, and then I let it sit, and then I kind of wait and come back to it. So, you know, I'll touch here and there, and maybe like in a week, you know, total, like, you know, time in the studio, maybe week and a half if I really have to like do shit.
Okay.
Like the really complicated tracks could take 2 weeks as well. If there's a lot of stuff and a lot of like harmonies and stuff you don't want to like mess up in there. It's easy to mess up too, so
yeah,
you have to hear everything. Sometimes you don't hear everything right away.
Cool. And do you feel like, I wanted to ask, like, studio wise and gigging wise, where do you feel more comfortable, like in the studio or like when you're gigging?
It's totally different.
Right?
Yeah, I can feel uncomfortable at a gig because of, some, I don't know, like tables sideways or something. But I know in my studio, I'm always comfortable because I have nice chairs. I know my stuff, and I know it's warm in here. You know,
it's my
cave. Yeah, but the gigs, I'm usually comfortable. It just depends. Yeah. Depends if you've slept or if you're like tired, or if you're hungry, or if you're like
jet lag.
Yeah. So there's all kinds of factors.
Yeah.
So yeah, definitely in the studio is more comfortable. Anyway,
And can I ask you also, like, what are some of your like favorite countries that you've played at?
A lot, actually.
A lot.
Argentina has an amazing public. It's a really great audience. They're really, really into it. Brazil obviously is wow. Always, it's a wow experience because the parties are enormous, and you know, you get to meet a lot of people. You can't connect with everybody. Mexico, because Mexico's in my heart, and also California's in my heart, so I have a lot of friends there, and it's nice to see them, you know, in that situation 25 years later, even they're still there. So
they're still there.
And then, of course, Japan. I love Japan. I'm sure, you know. And India, there's some great, you know, moments in Goa. And Europe, of course, there's, in general, Europe is more clubby, so it's a different vibe. But I like festivals. I like outdoors.
Yeah, and then I was going to ask you, what about festivals? What's like, can you name like maybe, I don't know, because I know it's kind of hard sometimes for artists to say that, but like maybe two or three of your favorite like festivals that you go to, or
well, the last time I played at Boom was amazing. That was big. It was amazing. It was the first time I played at Boom, and it was just incredible.
And when was that?
That was in 2018.
Okay.
Yeah. And then the whole thing happened, and you know.
Yeah.
So, but yeah, 2018 was the last one.
Okay.
It was
and incredible. That was your first time to play at Boom?
Yeah, I'd been there as a tourist or, yeah, you know, punter, but yeah, I never played.
Okay, wow, nice.
Yeah, of course, Ozora is amazing too. I played as Match right there a couple of times, and that was amazing too. We played after Spongle the first time. It was really, it's stuff that stays in your heart for sure.
Look who just came online.
Oh, King Romeo's there. Oh, gosh.
Hi, Romeo.
Hi, Romeo. How you doing? Good. That's nice. Good. Yeah. So that was a very amazing experience. All the parties in Brazil are amazing experience because of the size. You think you're in a stadium sometimes. But I like smaller gigs too.
I've never been to Azora yet, so maybe one day.
I'm sure you will. It'll come back, all of it.
Yeah.
For sure. Are you looking at the at the text?
Yeah, I'm guessing there's a lot of people that I can't see because they're coming from your side as well, Max. But there's like a lot of hearts and shit going up here, so there's quite a few people on here right now.
Okay, good. Yeah. Good.
Because I can see people coming in from your account as well. Hey, you sexy, he says.
Everybody's still up at this time, Romeo. Sunday night.
Yeah, it's like, it must be, I don't know what time it is in India. It must be like... Probably 1 or something?
Probably 1, yeah.
1:30?
Yeah. Something like that. He stayed up for it, eh? Such a good friend.
All the hardcore party animals here.
That's right.
Yeah.
So what else you got, Domino?
I also wanted to, talk about your label. What's coming up next with your label release wise? I know you just released something recently with, is it DJ Stryker?
Yeah, we had one called Forms of Life. That was the last one. And I took a little bit of a break because it was, I was a bit, you know, in another headspace, but... Yeah. But yeah, now we've got some new guys. One guy from Argentina called Nax, and he's really good. He's very, very good, very talented. So that's the next EP in a couple of weeks. And then we've got another new guy from Israel, which I really like. His name is Morganic. And he's very good, yeah. Very good taste music, all very classy. And that's coming out after. And then we just took on an artist, Z-Cat, from Russia. So we'll release some of her music too pretty soon.
Okay.
there'll be a High Riders EP as well. Those are all kind of newer guys. And then we'll have some Mad Tribe. We'll have some GMS Stryker, an album of Mechanica. There'll be Avalon and myself, a couple of those, even three, I think, three more. And I'm going to do probably an album at one point.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, a Mad Max album. Okay.
Cool. Yeah.
When was the last Mad Max album you did?
Oh, it's 2011.
Yeah. And okay. And then didn't you have a project with Nick?
No, we had a project with Bart and Jean-Marc from XSI. It was called Wild Monkeys.
Yes, I was going to ask you about Wild Monkeys. Are you going to do anything else, or are you like?
No. Done? No. We're not. It was a good project, though. It sounded
yeah,
cool.
I loved it.
Yeah, I remember. I remember you used to play a lot of it, yeah?
Oh, my God. I was such a big fan of them. Like the sound was so, like, fresh.
It was fresh, yeah? A bit electro as well. Yeah. Some grindy basses and, really, like, dirty stuff, yeah?
Yeah.
It was dirty stuff, yeah. It was a good style, actually.
Yeah, it was really good style. I don't know why you guys not gonna... Why are you not gonna do anything else?
Well... Better make something new now. You know?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Going back in the past sometimes doesn't really do it.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
But I mean that kind of style, like I don't know.
Yeah, yeah. Well, when I make a track with Bart, sometimes we go there a bit, you know, because it's still in us, of course, you know. So, But yeah, new stuff will come out anyway.
Yeah.
You know, similar stuff, or we'll see. But we're not going to do that again, though.
Okay.
Yeah.
You're not talking about me.
Oh, yeah. And then you've got Romeo's track coming out as well. That's coming out soon. He needs to send me some stuff that's not techno, though.
So, oh, okay. Is he doing techno now?
Yeah, Romeo loves techno.
Okay.
For sure.
I mean, so yeah, no. Okay, so you're not... Oh, yeah, then I want to ask you, have you got, like, any, like, you know, funny or crazy stories as you, like, have been at a party, either doing a live or back when you were DJing? Anything funny or crazy you can tell us of the experience that you had at all?
Oh, I'd have to go back and there's all these memories that are all foggy. I know I have only memories like this, but to pinpoint one is like...
Okay, well, you can tell us a few then.
Yeah, well, even a few. Now I have to remember them.
Okay.
They kind of just come like that. Oh, yeah, this happened. And I wouldn't want to tell you a so-so one, but, you know, I want to tell
Why
you.
Why not?
I wasn't expecting the question. Sorry.
Okay.
Yeah, no, I would.
Like,
I have
anything,
to like.
Like
get back
anything,
to
like
that.
You know, being at the meeting, a part. Like, I've got loads of like stories, man. Like, holy, that's happened. But,
oh, I'm sure you have. Yeah, I'm sure.
Yeah.
You have. Yeah. So tell me one short one then. Maybe it'll like stimulate my memories.
Well, I mean, way back when I first started DJing, when I first like was DJing around Europe, like I was playing a lot of those in France, for instance, and the party got raided by cops, and I was the pretty much, unbeknownst to me, obviously the organizer and all of that had disappeared, and I was like left there DJing, and all of a sudden my friend came and said, you better like run, and I looked behind me and it was like cops with like dogs, and I like just had to like, I didn't even have time to get my DAT tapes or anything, I just had to like freaking leg it, and I was like running through this freaking, and it was like this forest and it was pitch black and fell down this huge hole. Yeah, things like that, you know.
Yeah that sounds like a psytrance party.
Yeah
Well, see, you stimulated my memory, thank you.
Yeah,
so I have a story actually, and I was just talking about it with one of the guys I was with at that moment. And so it was in Turkey.
Okay.
And I was driving to the festival in Turkey and with a van. And I had this guy, Bitkit, with me and another guy. We got lost. So we got lost in the mountain. So finally the van gets onto the cliff and it's like about to fall. So we said, fuck. And we don't know where the party is because the guy's lost, obviously. Yeah? So there's no GPS back then as well. And so we kind of like, the van's kind of stable. Yeah, still okay. And so me and the driver go to look for the party. And I had to find the party with my ears.
Because
there's no way. It was about an hour to get to the party. But we had to really, like, so finally get to the party. And the organizer, I don't know what's going on and stuff. It's pretty much a mess, obviously, psytrance party. And finally, we said, okay, we got to go get the guy again. So we have to walk back the whole mountain and stuff and come back to the guy. The guy's gone. He left. You know? It's like, fuck. And the bags and things locked. It's like, fuck, we don't have the key. So we have to go back again another hour. Yeah. So, but the
oh
time
my
is gone.
God.
And get the key. And then that's fine. I think I have to come back again to open the stuff to get and so. That was already hours. So you're really tired once you have to play. Yeah. And you haven't thought about your set at all because you've been thinking about this whole thing. And you didn't eat anything, obviously. So you finally eat some like barbecue thing and stuff. And then, so yeah, finally I would have to sleep. So I wanted to sleep so there's nowhere to sleep, obviously. And you had this air mattress. It was about this big and it would just move with the bass. It would just keep moving with the bass. And the windows were broken, so you, of course, you see.
Oh my god!
finally get to play, and then and it's time to go home. And then they left me on top of the mountain. And I said, no, okay, so, you know, we're going to bring you down there, and then you're on your own. And you got to go home. And I didn't know where you are, you know? And I was in this, like, village in Turkey. And what do you do? So what do you do? So you have to, like, look for a hotel, and there's no hotel. And you got your suitcase, and everybody's looking at you, and you're like, it's just a small place. And finally, you say, fuck. So, because you've gotten yourself back to the village. You're really happy about yourself, you know, proud of yourself. Yeah, for getting yourself off that mountain, yeah? Somehow. Without probably no pain.
Hey, Romeo.
Yeah. Then finally got myself to the airport hotel after I don't know how many hours. And yeah, you're really, really pissed after that. You're really pissed after that.
We already spoke about On Beach, man. Yeah, you'll have to watch the interview from the beginning.
Yeah, On Beach was that was a long time ago.
Yeah.
So yeah, that was one of the stories. There's a lot of stories in Japan as well, I'm sure.
Oh yeah.
Like, yeah, it gets pretty crazy in Japan as well. Yeah. Back then, especially.
I only have good things in Japan. I mean, all my like crazy stories are like either in India, France. I had an experience in Spain. No, in Ibiza. Some like bizarre ones.
There's some bizarre things.
Yeah.
We are in the side trance scene.
Huh?
We are in the side trance scene. There's bizarre things happen. Yeah. For sure.
But then also, I guess, also from like being a female, like you get other funny, like, you know, things that maybe wouldn't happen to a guy. I don't know, but yeah.
Oh yeah. Oh, for sure. For sure.
Yeah. Well, I was wondering now, because once I post this, we don't get to see all the comments. That's the only thing about doing the live interview.
Yeah.
So I'm wondering if you want to scroll. Can you see all the messages? I'm wondering if you want to scroll down, because there's probably some people here who've been asking some stuff that you might, I don't know if you want to reply to. So we're not saying it's a bit rude.
Let's see.
I guess I could have asked that, because somebody says here, oh, where is it? Can we hear some stories about you and Ollie? I think there was something.
Stories about me and Ollie. Well, I told this basically the story about me and Ollie, the whole story. Yeah.
Well, can you see them?
I just see people joined. I don't see many questions. I think you asked quite a bit of good questions, actually.
Okay.
Yeah. And we went to a lot of places, actually, yeah. We covered quite a bit of ground at Domino.
Yeah, we did.
Yeah, from the roof.
I wanted to ask you, you know, as now that you've, you know, been doing, like, how long have you been making music? For how many years in total, Max?
I started with my dad, actually. I made my first track when I was 14 with him. And it was
14?
Yeah, but that was like, you know, but it was a track. And he actually was the one I made the first trance track with. So we figured it out with the kick, the bass. It was, you know, it was completely weird, but it was fun. And so he was in his studio. We did that when I was 18.
Huh? Okay.
And then he gave me his computer, and he gave me some stuff, and then I could start making music, you know, battling around. And then I got together with Nick and Sam, and that's where I, you know, got the kind of proper production training a bit. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. I saw up here somebody was asking, when are you coming back to Greece? And then somebody was saying, when are you coming to back to New York? When are you coming to Goa?
To Goa, I think middle of the year, maybe end of the season. I think maybe even for my birthday. Let's see. March 6th is my birthday. Yeah.
Huh?
March 6th is my birthday, so I think I should be there by my birthday.
Okay, cool.
Yeah. In Greece, I don't know. Not sure. And we don't know, because it's changing every day.
Yeah, right. With with this whole situation. I wanted to ask you also, what's your next gig coming up?
Christmas Day here in Spain.
Okay.
In Barcelona. And then New Year's in Portugal.
Oh, nice.
And then, January, a big party in Marseille in France with Aja and Tristan. It's called PsyMind.
Oh, cool.
And then probably a U.S. tour in February I'm working on.
Okay.
So let's see, let's see if it happens and all that, but it should happen. So, yeah, I'm working on some stuff for sure.
So you're looking pretty busy then.
As much as I can. Yeah,
Somebody's asking, Max, what is your zodiac sign? Domino, what is your zodiac sign?
What are you, Sagittarius? No, Domino.
I'm Sagittarius because my birthday is next week, November 29th.
Yeah, that's right. I'm Pisces.
And I'll be 49 years old. Like, oh my God.
Jesus, Domino. Oh my God.
Yeah.
Yeah, we're getting up there, huh?
I'm getting up there.
Well, you look good.
I'm getting up there.
You're looking great.
Hopefully next year I can blast it somewhere with all you party animals for my 50th. It would be awesome.
Well, 50 if you have to party, huh?
Yeah.
Like, you're going to have to get out of Canada in there.
Somehow, yeah.
Yeah. Get out to a nice festival or a few.
Yeah, hopefully.
50, you have to party, sure.
Yeah. And I also wanted to say a big thank you to you, Max, because you've always been, like, super amazing with me, like, in the sense of always saying, if you say you're going to send me some music, you always do. So I really appreciate that, like, a lot.
You're welcome, guys.
Yeah, you've been, like, really great.
Well, I know you played and I know you like it, so.
Yeah, I love all your stuff, like, all your stuff and everything from your label, you know. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you.
I've always been a huge fan, so.
Good. Well, you keep getting the music anyway. Not to worry.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And, yeah, and it's been, like, really amazing that you, and thank you so much for doing this interview. You know,
thank you.
Taking time out and doing it.
Well, it's fun. It's my first time. You popped my cherry finally.
Oh, really? First time for you to do an interview?
Well, no, like this on the, you know, like
on
this.
On Instagram.
Yeah. This way. Yeah.
And I hope you enjoyed it because I tried to make it as relaxed as possible.
No, like, I really did. It's like sitting down with you and having a chat. And that's it's like having a phone call with you.
Yeah.
And people can enjoy it too.
Yeah.
It's the new way. It's the new way.
Yeah. Oh, thank you so much, guys.
Well, thank you. Thank you, guys.
Yeah. Thank you, everybody, here for your love and support.
I love all you guys, too.
Yeah.
Nice. And, nice to know all these people are here.
Yeah. And there's still people joining, like, as we speak. So, yeah.
Okay. Well, I got my guest coming.
You got your dinner happening
pretty
soon.
I made Japanese curry.
Yeah, Japanese curry. Enjoy your meal.
Oh, I forgot to put the rice. Shit.
Oh, it shouldn't take too long to do the rice.
No, it should be fine.
It should be fine.
I have the rice cooker. It's some happy birthday melody when you put it on. It's really fun.
Oh, Mom's still on here. She's saying big love to you, Max.
Big love to you. Oh, man, it's really good.
Thanks both for everything. Have a great day. You too, S-Range.
S-Range.
Yeah, S-Range, Romeo, Mom, Mark, Sky, Stryker was on there, I think.
Yeah, it was really good to have everybody here.
Yeah, thank you so much.
Oh, Depeche, even Depeche is there.
Oh, Depeche is there too? Oh, cool.
Yeah, we got the whole family.
Cool.
Yeah, look at that. You put a little palm tree.
Oh. I'm looking forward to, you know, all your releases coming out.
Good, Dom. Thanks. Yeah. Me too. Yeah. I'm gonna work a lot.
And sending you lots of love and good vibes and just thank you so much again, once again.
You're welcome. Thank you for doing this.
It's been a real pleasure.
It's really good. It's been a pleasure too, Domino. Thank you. So how do we do it? We just have to, like, hang up?
Yeah, we just have to hang up. Yeah.
Hang up. Oh, I can do that. Old. You don't have to, you can't ask too much of me. Bye, Domino.
Bye. See you.
Bye, guys.
Bye.
Thanks for watching.
Bye. Oh, and before I go, I just want to remind everybody that if you want to, like, if you want to watch all the interviews, like, and choose which one you want to watch, if you go to YouTube, I've posted them on YouTube, so it's easier for you guys just to go there and watch whatever you want to watch. Okay.
There you go.
All right.
Bye, guys.